Watch over our pastor and his wife, Father, while they're away, Lord.
Yes.
Let them be able to have a good time, Father.
Yes.
And Lord, get them back home safe.
Yes.
Father, we ask you to watch over the worship this morning, Father.
Yes.
God.
Yes.
And we're here to give you the praise and the honor that you deserve, Lord.
Yes. Yes.
And Lord, we just want to say thank you once again. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Glory
to
God.
Thank you.
I promise. Father, 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 I'm reading from the King James Version. The word says that, brethren, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. It might be used for talking, making the right choices. Now, one of the most common things that we say as adults, both young and old, is, if I knew then what I know now, I would have done things a whole lot different. I don't know about anybody else, but that's one of my, I see it a lot of times when I reflect back on decisions that I've made in the past. A lot of times I say, if I knew then what I know now, we've done it a whole lot differently. Not that I would have ended up in a different place, mm-hmm. but I would have ended up in a better place a lot sooner. You have a lot of athletes, when you read the documentaries on TV, they say, well, if I had known 20 years ago what the effects of steroids would have done on my body, I never would have taken it. The drug addicts and alcoholics say, if I had known when I was drinking that alcohol and taking those drugs, if I had known the effects that it would have on my physical body, if I had known that it would cause me to lose everything that I have, I never would have had anything to do with it. But it's not just about athletes and drug addicts. We can say that about all walks of life. It all comes down to choices. And we're oftentimes faced with very serious life choices. And they're serious because the choices that we make, let's face it, oftentimes don't just affect us. Affect our spouses, affect our children, affect our colleagues, they affect every aspect of our lives. In Deuteronomy, 30th chapter, God told the Israelites that he was setting before them some choices. He said, I'm setting before them life and death. Blessings and curses. And God in the 30th chapter of Deuteronomy, he encouraged them to choose life. In the 24th chapter of the book of Joshua, Joshua said, he says, and if it seem evil unto you to serve Jehovah, choose ye this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your father served that were beyond the river, or whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Joshua understood something. Joshua understood that when your choice is to honor God, when your choices honor God, you'll never have any regret. But we're living in a time when most people are consumed with success and winning. People do almost anything to be considered successful. Whatever it takes to win, they're willing to do. That's when you really find out the true character of people. Put in front of them what success and what the world calls success and what the world calls failure. And they'll do anything they can to get on that side of success, whether in politics, whether in athletics, whether in business. It doesn't matter. People oftentimes make that choice because they make choices they make because they focus on instant gratification. And the only motivation is to satisfy those instant desires. But they do that a lot of times because the choices they make are not founded in God. Well, that's why people do almost anything. People who have a foundation in God will have a moral sense. They will say, no, I'm not going to do anything. But I'm going to make a choice that will honor God. People who look for self-gratification can only see the now. They have no sense of vision of what's to come. And Paul said, many live as enemies of the cross. He's talking about such people who has that instant gratification, who looking for that instant gratification. They are enemies of the cross of Christ. He said, but their destiny is destruction. Their God is their stomach and their glory is in their shame. Their mind is on earthly things. But Paul goes on to say, but our citizenship is in heaven and we eagerly await the Savior. Savior Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control will transform our lowly bodies so that we will be like his glorious body. Yeah. Paul says that you have a choice here. You can focus on earthly things or you can choose citizenship in heaven. Paul says that you can allow your stomach to be what it is, what you obtain through your greed and your lust for the things of this world. You can choose that to be your God, or you can worship the one true God. Your destiny can be destruction, or your destiny can be eternal life. But whether you believe it or not, at some point you got to make that choice. Paul warns us not to focus on the things of this world. And he said, why is that? He said, because you have nothing to look forward to. He said, because people who focus on the things of this world, you have to understand that they are dying every day. Mm-hmm. And they die in three significant ways. One, they're dying physically. Mm-hmm. We all know that everybody is dying physically. From the time that you were born, you began to die. Mm-hmm. We look in the mirror every day and we see signs of aging. When you reach a certain age, it's like going uphill. You're young, you're strong, you're fast, and all these things. But then once you reach the top of the mountain, you start coming down. And when you start coming down, that's when you start seeing the wrinkles. Huh. When you look in the mirror, that's when the hair starts to turn gray. You cover it up. But you and I both know it's great. That's when you try to run like you used to run. You're not as fast as you used to be. You're not as strong as you used to be. Because your body, slowly but surely, has begun the dying process. The dying process has begun. But people who choose the things of the world, not only are they dying physically, but they're dying spiritually. There are times in everybody's life when you are more sensitive to the things of God than at other times. Amen. See, the Holy Spirit comes and he offers redemption that comes through Jesus Christ, the price that was paid for our sins. And it is in those moments that our spirit responds to God's spirit. And when our spirit responds to God's spirit, we have the opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior.
Yes. But if you keep letting those moments pass, when the Spirit, the Holy Spirit speak to you, and you keep letting that moment pass where you say no, and you don't accept the Holy Spirit, you don't accept Him, Jesus Christ, as your Lord and Savior, after a while, God, I'm not ready, I can't do it right now. Maybe later, come back and see me later. If you keep doing that, what happens is that we reach a point where we're no longer sensitive to God, and we begin to die spiritually. Look around. We live in a world that is dying spiritually. We're no longer shocked by what we see, by what we hear. I remember a time when you would look on TV, and if somebody said a curse word, you would be saying, oh my God, did you hear that? Now if they don't curse, it's not a good show.
Amen.
Wasn't a good show. I don't know how many of you look at the show Greenleaf. Greenleaf is a show about a church. It comes on Wednesday nights on OWN. And it's a show about a black church in Memphis, Tennessee. It's a mega church. And started on, it came and started last season, this second season. One of my favorite shows. The issues of the mega churches. But then they started, one of the daughters was married to this guy. She is married to this guy. They just got divorced, but they were married, and the reason they got divorced is because he started questioning his sexuality. And I'm like, oh God, y'all about to ruin a good show. Y'all about to ruin a good show. It's not necessary that you have to put homosexuality into everything. And so when the show went off, he was still questioning. He was denying that he was gay, but he was still a sense of him questioning. He wasn't out of the closet, but he had one foot in and one foot out. And then there was this young lawyer who was staying at the house. They stayed in this big mansion. And I guess the dad wanted all the kids to stay in the house, so most of the kids stayed in the house. And they had this suite, and he was in the suite, and he and his wife had just had a baby. And he was talking to this young lawyer who came out and do some work for them, to stand with them. And they're sitting there watching TV, and he tells him, he says, thank you for all the help you've done for me. Boy, when he did it, he reached over, he just touched his hand. I'm like, oh, Lord, don't tell me it's going down this road. But when the show went off, by the time the show went off, they embrace him, and they're kissing. And I'm like, you're taking a good show, and you just ruined it because you have no sense of spirituality. You miss a whole show, and they're quoting scriptures the whole show. And they're praising God the whole show. And then they just, in order to satisfy the worldly desires of the audience that's there, they have to put worldly things in it. They put homosexuality into a good show. But when we look at that and our children look at that and they say, well, they're at church, so it's okay. And they can become consumed with it. And they're being pulled further and further and further away from the true gospel. People began to die spiritually when we began to accept the things of the world over the things of God. But not only do people die spiritually, not only do they die physically, but without Christ you will die eternally. Romans 6:23 said the wages of sin is death. And a world without Christ is a world destined for destruction. We have to be mindful that our citizenship, our true citizenship, the children of God, our citizenship is in heaven. And we eagerly await a Savior. John 10:10 says that Christ says, I have come to give you life, and that more abundantly. You cannot be enamored by the glitz and the glamour, the fancy cars and the mansions of the green leaves that we see on TV, and say to yourself, well, you know, wow, that's how I want to live. Because don't be deceived, because to live that way without Christ is not living, is actually dying. You're saying, that's how I want to die. I want the gratification of right now. I want everybody to see me driving down the street in a Maybach. I want everybody to see my house on the hill. I want everybody to see me in my fine suits. I want everybody to see my wallet when I pull it out and the credit cards drop down to the floor. I want everybody to see just how rich I am. I want everybody to see just how gratified I am right now. Don't be deceived. They're not really living. They're really going through the motions of living. But I believe that there's more than that. You see, because for every credit card that drops to the floor, there's a limit. For every suit that you can wear, there's a moth. For every brick that you build on that mountain, there's decay. For every Maybach or Mercedes that you drive, there's a breakdown. It doesn't last. So the things of the world that gratify us instantly does not last. But I believe that life is more than that. I believe that there's an abundant life that God promises us that goes beyond the physical, goes beyond this earthly life, that brings us into the presence of God with a life that never ends, where I can look into the mirror and I don't have to worry about, I'm not checking for wrinkles, because I know there'll be no more wrinkles. I'm not checking for gray hairs. There'll be no more. I'm not worried about my aching bones. I'm not worried about all my sorrows and my heartache. My abundant life is my citizenship in heaven, and it is an eternal life. For tomorrow, when I wake up and I look in that same mirror, I'm perfect. 100 years from now, when I look in that same mirror, I'll still be perfect. I'll be perfect not only for 100 years, but for an eternity. That's because my focus and my choice is not on earthly things, but on God. You have to make a choice. You can grab whatever you can grab right now for the moment and forget about everything else and live for now on this earth. And you may have a moment of happiness. You may have a year or two of happiness and gratification. But are you looking for a better, greater, eternally abundant life?
Yes.
Because I tell you, no matter how many cars you park in the driveway, no matter how many houses you build, I guarantee some days you're going to be driving down the street. You're going to pull up into the garage, and you're going to walk into that house, and you're going to experience some sorrow. I don't care. Sometimes, no matter how beautiful the house is, no matter how beautifully you are arrayed, sometimes tears are going to fall down your eyes. Sometimes you're going to sit down at the table, there's not going to be a meal, and you're going to rub your belly and say, I'm hungry. Sometimes you're going to lay down in the bed, not because you're tired, but because you're hurting. Sometimes this life is going to tell you, I fooled you. You thought everything that I offered you was good. You thought everything was beautiful. Everything was abundant, but I fooled you. You see, now you were healthy last year. You're sick today. You had a car that was beautiful last year. It's old today. You had a brand new house 10 years ago. It's old today, and it's falling apart. I fooled you. You should have chose God. You should have chosen an abundant life where he promised you streets of gold, where he promised you that you would have a mansion that would never decay, where he promised you that you would have a glorious body that would never get old, that your hair would never gray, that your heart would never experience sorrow, that you have no more aches, that you have no more pain. You should have chosen God, but I fooled you. Now, but you while I'm talking, I'm still living this earthly life. Yeah. I can put all that stuff behind me and look up to heaven and say, God, I choose you. Yeah. The Bible tells me, say, what shall it profit a man to gain the whole world and then mess around and lose his soul? Don't let life fool you. You have a choice. Make that choice. Make that choice, Jesus.
Holy, 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 word, holy, word, holy, hallelujah, holy, word, hallelujah, hey, hey, what a word, amen, what a word of life, what a word of eternal life coming from minister today, amen, amen, let us receive it. Not just mess around, but let